Well, greetings, strangers. Been a few weeks since I've been here. Let's see, I was in Columbus, Ohio, and then Huntington, West Virginia, and then last week in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. So, three Sabbaths in a row, I've had to be out of town. And I imagine I have a few more of those coming up because we're going to be somewhere close to our 28 to 30 of those personal appearance campaigns, kind of a pretentious word for only one sermon for an hour and 10 or 20 minutes at some of these areas that I go to. But we've had some very good audiences and we've had some very good results. Quite a number of people beginning to attend church and a number of new baptismal requests. I saw a big stack of letters the other day that came in as a result of my third class letter, probably representing 65 or 70 people, I think 30 separate letters from families who want to be visited by some of our own church brethren who will be fanning out from their local areas. And here and there, there are people who have been counseled on how to counsel for baptism and personal visits. And I think in that way, we can cover every part of the country from coast to coast with baptismal requests. And we have quite a stack of them coming in, which is really encouraging to see. You probably noticed in the news recently that the U.S. Supreme Court has approved a Texas State Supreme Court law that has to do with the instruction of juries involving the death penalty in Texas. There was a peculiar Texas law that does not exist in most other states. It has to do with the instructions going to a jury involving whether the death sentence can or should be carried out in a particular method or not, involving injection, as opposed to life imprisonment for the infraction of murder under certain circumstances. Now, you're all familiar with the fact that several years back, there was no such thing as the capital punishment for murder in the United States. And then finally, after the Warren Court was no longer ensconced, wiser heads prevailed, and finally, a few years back, the death penalty was put in once again. And so in most places now, at least it is legal, according to the U.S. Supreme Court, a person can suffer the penalty of death for capital murder. That is, murder in the first degree that is absolutely proved to be with wanton, premeditated intent, and where the person is not going to get a cop-out, as they say, by not guilty by reason of insanity, as they claimed Hinckley was not guilty. You know, hundreds of millions of people saw him shoot the president, but he wasn't guilty. He didn't do it by reason of insanity. You know, mankind likes to curse God, take the name of God, take the name of Jesus Christ, use it in casual conversation on the Johnny Carson show, use it in profanity, trample the Sabbath underfoot, ignore, or better yet, simply spit on or ridicule the Ten Commandments and the laws of God, try to pull God down to the human level, and then exalt ourselves and call ourselves more righteous than God, more tender, more merciful, more understanding, more generous, more forgiving, more patient than God. And we do this by coining a phrase which is called humanitarianism. Not godly, mind you, but humanitarianism. So the courts fight these battles about capital punishment based upon what is not godly, but humane. So it is more humane, they say, to take a rotten serial killer, like one of these idiots in Chicago where they're getting the earth movers to dig up the bodies like a veritable graveyard where he may have murdered hundreds of people, we don't really know yet, in a torture chamber where he would take them several at a time, apparently, and watch them scream as they died. And in order to be humane, what we do is the nurse comes along and they go like that so you don't really feel the needle. You ever had a shot? Most people in this room had a shot. You've had a vaccination. It's a world in which there's a great deal of medical assistance provided for youngsters in school where the nurses will come along and it's pretty much county or state or federal or whatever subsidized and they give you the inoculations for free. I remember so well the corpsman who was saying, oh, my life is full of pins and needles and we're going along, got about two of them hanging out of our shoulder. And they come along with about a dozen needles in a box and just kind of put them in your shoulder like darts. And another guy comes along and I'm going to make somebody faint. I better quit. Anyway, then they screw in the thing and they give you the inoculation. When you first check into the services, they give you something like 6 or 7 in the first day. Well, they develop a technique to where they hold the needle here and they just slap you right quick. And the sting from the slap takes away the bite of the needle. You literally don't feel it. So they had this thing in, like when I had my operation, it was quite humane. I'm lying there and feeling better by the moment because they've already given me something to kind of lighten my mood, and they're going to put me under to take some broken bone out of my elbow. And as I've told the story before, Mr. Dart had had an operation and told me that they had him count backwards from 100, and he said 99, 98, and they didn't remember. So I'm waiting for the nurse to tell me, now, begin counting backward from 100. And she said, are you ready? And I thought she meant, are you ready to start counting backward from 100? I said, yes. And she said, are you ready to go back to your room? And I looked around, I had a bandage on my arm, and the operation was over. And I've described that because it is the closest experience, I think, to death that you can have. You've never slept so soundly in your entire life. I mean, I'm conscious of the passing of time. I talk in my sleep. I groan a lot, I hurt, I have backaches, one thing and the other. So I'll wake up kind of half asleep and maybe say a full sentence that doesn't make any sense out of my dreams. But I never sleep so totally deep that I just, it's like 1 second later I wake up and I've been in bed for 8 hours. But I could have been out 8 hours or 10 hours or 10 years and the experience would have been the same. I was out about an hour and a half or two. And the experience would have been the same. A very humane way to put me out of my conscious state. And the way the state of Texas and many other states exact the ultimate punishment for the most heinous, bestial acts that one human being can commit to another is identical to what that nurse did to me to get me ready for an operation. And we exalt ourselves and say, that is humane. I want to turn to the book of Hebrews and read something right quickly that is a description of God. This is a very marked contrast between the argument that the Apostle Paul makes with regard to the great, fabulous sights that were seen for 40 solid years when the Israelites were at the foot of Mount Sinai and then journeying through the wilderness. And he began in verse 18 to say, you, that is in this dispensation, this time of general acceptance before God, of an opportunity for repentance, an opportunity to receive God's Holy Spirit universally, be we Jewish or Gentile, you are not come unto the mount that might be touched. You can't walk over there to a precipitous cliff or a huge mountain and climb part way up or all the way to the top as Moses did. And that burned with fire. There was a huge, enfolding, rolling cloud, and there was flame seen at the base of that cloud when Moses was up there receiving the law. Nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest, and that's just like being in the very cell of a thunderstorm or a great hurricane, and the sound of a trumpet, which they literally heard, and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. And it was the voice of an archangel as a mediator who was actually delivering the voice of Almighty God, because Christ said later in the book of John, you have neither seen his face nor heard his voice at any time. So it was a messenger sent from God, but they heard an audible voice that shouted so loud it sounded like standing at the foot of Niagara. For they could not endure that which was commanded. And if so much as a beast touched the mountain, it was a holy place, it shall be stoned or thrust through with a dart. And so terrible, so awesome was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. It made his knees knock, his hands were trembling. It just literally made him shake. That was a physical manifestation. Fire, noise, a trumpet, an earthquake, and a voice they could not decipher. But you are come unto Mount Zion. Now, this is a spiritual metaphor. Mount Zion is a literal mountain just outside Jerusalem. And unto the city of the living God, a city that we're told is in heaven, where God dwells, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable, countless, you cannot number them, company of angels. Billions? No, probably hundreds of billions. To the general assembly of the church of the firstborn, another way of saying the church of God, which is the church of Christ that is the church of which he is head, the church of the firstborn, as he is called in Romans 8:29, the firstborn from the dead, which are written in heaven. Is your name there, middle initial in place, spelled correctly? Is it on the ledger up there? And to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men, interesting language, made perfect. As we understand in God's church, there is the spirit of man, or the human spirit, and the new creature in Christ that is actually gradually growing day by day through Bible study, through prayer, through your own spiritual overcoming in the womb, as it were, by metaphor, that is the church, through an exercise just such as this of coming to church, of hearing sermons and sermonettes, of looking at the Word of God, the spiritual new man that is called the new creation in Christ, the inward character, is the spirits of just men that are being made gradually perfect. And to Jesus, the mediator of the new will, the new agreement, the new covenant, and of the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. See that you refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escaped who refused him that spake on earth, escaped not, I'm sorry, if they escaped not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaks from heaven, that is Christ and the Word of God, whether written or audible, whose voice then shook the earth, but now he has promised, saying, yet once more, I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word, quoting, yet once more, signifies the removing of those things that are shaken. Strange language, means doing away with all the material physical earth as we know it. Removing those things that are shaken. No more earth, no more stratified layer of rock, as we will soon see. As of things that are made, physical material substances. That those things which remain, which cannot be shaken, that is spiritual things, may remain. And that's all that is going to remain ultimately. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, not an earthly throne, and not a kingdom which depends upon physical facilities or huge buildings or balustrades or gigantic columns or huge pavilions or thrones or anything of the kind that you would see like in the Capitol building in Washington or some of the great fabulous government buildings of the capital cities of the world. We receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear, for our God is a consuming fire. Now, without belaboring the point, is God humane? How did God display his wrath on the occasion of administering capital punishment to a rotten bunch of filthy sodomites? Did a nurse come along, lay them all down, get them all cleaned up, and swab them with alcohol and tap them nicely, insert a little needle, and then say, are you ready?
Yes.
You know, and then just shoot the sodium pentothal to them? No. No, if you could have somehow been there, you would have seen the ultimate dance. I remember a man who was probably one of the most profane human beings in the world, who was a very famous comedian. I guess that's the word for people like that. He was experimenting with drugs on one occasion, and I guess he was what they call freebasing cocaine. And he was in a room somewhere, and I think it involves fire, maybe a Bunsen burner or a butane burner and the spoon and the stuff to melt it down to get it into some kind of an amber liquid of some kind, I don't know the whole process, by which he could then shoot it directly into his veins. And I don't know whether some of the liquid he was using spilled on him or how it got started, but he caught fire. And it burned him pretty bad. Singed his hair off, burned his clothes, disfigured him somewhat. He used to make a lot of jokes about that later on. He recovered, and I guess finally he recovered from drugs. And then he began telling the story about, man, when you on fire, you really run. When you on fire, you do funny things, man. And I mean, the audience would sit out there and just laugh and get the biggest kick out of the fact that here's this drug addict who nearly burned himself to death,
survive the experience. Talk about, man, when you on fire, you can bring a 100-yard dash. I could have run 106 flat. He going on and on.
Well, I'll tell you, those people in Sodom and Gomorrah did really funny things. I won't go into great detail, but I want to explain something about Gehenna fire. We all know that Jesus Christ of Nazareth described a place, which is a valley right near Jerusalem, which was owned by a family for generations known as Hinnom. And so it would have been as familiar a place as saying, some nearby town or some well-known valley or some topographical feature that has a definitive name right near Tyler, like Brushy Creek or whatever it would be. And so Jesus said that they would be cast into a place called Gehenna. And the people could relate to that because that was the town dump. And that's where they shoved over the refuse, and it tumbled down there. We used to go to Orr, Minnesota, public dump. And up at Orr, Minnesota, back before I guess they'd passed some of the anti-pollution laws that they have now today, there was a horrible dump. You had to drive way up north of town, then back through some thickets of very thick trees, balsams and white bark birch and all kinds of conifers and Norway pines. You go back in there, and here was a huge dump. It was always just smoldering and slowly burning. And if you could stand the stench, both from the terrible smoke that kind of clung in there and didn't have much wind to blow it out down in that copse of trees, you know, and then the garbage, which is rotting, and all the refuse they threw in there. There were big rats that ran around. We used to have a lot of fun. We'd take 22s and wait for them in the evening and try to shoot those rats. Well, later on, just about full dark, the bears would come out. And one by one, here they'd come. And you could be there and see as many as 6 or 8 bears at a time, some of them just huge. Wild bears that come in there to lick the cans and eat the stuff that people would throw away. And it was a garbage dump. And assumedly, if somebody's poor cat died and they didn't want to bury it, or one got ran over in the street and the city people came along and threw it in the back of the truck, that's where the animal ended up, out there at the Orr dump. Then the rats got it. That's what Gehenna was. Gehenna was a dump. And they set fire to it. And it was known then for the fact that it was like the city sanitation department, not like we have them today, indoors with a huge kind of a furnace where they burn it, and then some kind of a big, I don't know how they put a catalytic converter, some kind of stack technology or other, where they're able to burn this type of thing and then filter out most of the rotten soot and the ashes so it doesn't spew all over the landscape, but hopefully they do so. And they have a little more, you know, clean ways of disposing of trash and junk today, landfills. Believe it or not, there's a hotel at Industry City. This is a hard thing for you to understand, but it's true. I'm not lying to you. Where for many, many years, decades perhaps, in Los Angeles, they built a mountain out of trash. And they rolled big D8s over it. And year after year after year, they just keep pushing dirt over layers of trash. And finally, they had this whole big hill there. And they began to discover that this trash underneath there was generating an incredible amount of heat. Today, there is a beautiful Sheraton Hotel, 2 18-hole golf courses on top of that mountain. And underneath it, they have pipes that go all the way down through there, and heat and hot water is provided to that hotel from that gigantic landfill atop which a hotel sits, which is a trash dump. Well, Gehenna burned day and night. So when Jesus Christ talked about the Pharisees who were accusing him of being an emissary of Satan the devil, accusing very wonderful acts of healing and miracles as being attributable to Satan the devil, he said they were in danger of Gehenna. And they knew exactly what he meant. One time a man came to me and said he was so relieved when he heard that I didn't believe in an ever-burning hell. And he'd read that document that shows what the Bible really says about Hades, which means the grave, about Sheol in the Old Testament, that merely means the grave or the pit, a place of the dark, dank place where the dead go that has nothing to do with infernal regions or high temperatures. And he was very relieved that there wasn't going to be an ever-burning hell. Well, we talked a little while, but you know, I don't know why you would be relieved, because the threat is identical. It's merely the duration of the time during which you do the dance. Now, I don't want to be macabre about it, but I do want to be serious enough about it to show you what the Bible does say. Because it says our God is a consuming fire.
In the second chapter, well, let's go to the second book, I'm sorry, third chapter of the book of Peter, we will see a very fabulous prophecy. It's very hard to really understand this with our human physical minds because it's hard to imagine something on such a scale. It's like going back to the motion pictures we may have seen that try to show for us creation or the Big Bang or the formation of the earth itself. He said, beginning in the third chapter in verse 3, that there would come scoffers who walk after their own lust. And I say, where's this promise about this Jesus coming back? What are you talking about? Religion. Aren't they all just a lot of fakers and charlatans? I mean, look at Swaggart and Baker and the rest of them. Nuts to religion. I mean, where's all this stuff about religion, churchianity, Christianity, and the Jesus trip? You ever hear people talk that way? The whole Jewish race does. You ever hear the stories about one of our boys made it? You can't even begin to repeat the stories that Jewish families tell their children growing up about Jesus. But it's true, they do. Where's the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, everything goes on just like it always did from the beginning of the creation. This is not the big drought. This doesn't presage the beginning of the great tribulation. It's cyclical in nature. It'll rain pretty soon, and then 5, 6, 8 years from now, we'll have another one. It'll just be a mild one, but then it'll be a lot of good wet years in between. All things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. It's just cyclical, a pendulum back and forth. For this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water. Many, many times, as a matter of fact. Geology proves that there were many inundations of the continental landmasses. Howbeit, he is speaking here of the Noachian deluge, or the flood of Noah, whereby the world that then was, and there was an organized world of maybe 4 billion people on the earth, being overflowed with water, perished. Something so mind-boggling, the mind refuses to accept it, and even most theologians, and many who believe they know something about biblical archaeology, insist that the flood of Noah was a local event. But you know, a man can get in a fast horse and run away from a flood. And the Bible says that all life perished, except those in the ark with Noah. But the heavens and the earth, which are now, that's now where we are, by the same word and only by that command and by that decision from Almighty God, are kept in store. So think of yourselves as being in store, set by. Now these people down here at Huntsville and all over the Texas prison system, and they can't build them fast enough. Matter of fact, if you want to get into a good business, which I understand is quite lucrative, get yourself some investors and go build yourself a jail. You can make a lot of money. One of my neighbors goes down every day down here somewhere about 100 miles and goes to work, not that far, I don't think, in one of these Texas prison systems, in a minimum security prison. So they got minimum and maximum security. We have federal penitentiaries. We got the military prisons. We've got the state prison systems. We got county jails and city jails. And we got hundreds of thousands of inmates and probably several million more who ought to be in there and aren't. But that isn't the way to solve society's problems anyway, by sweeping them under the carpet and claiming it don't really exist, by putting people in jail to, quote, do time, end quote. That is not the way God established punishment in ancient Israel, when it was literally a theocracy or a blend of church and state. But we're in a storehouse. We're being preserved, kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition, that's destruction, of ungodly men. Is that humane? But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. So even though it seems to go on interminably, and in your lifetime, you look back and say, well, it's been a long time. I have people come up to me and say, I'm 74 years young. And there's a kind of a vanity of old age that I've noticed that we get into. There's a vanity of youth. There's a vanity of middle age, a vanity of people that look for compliments by telling you how old they are. It means nothing. It's less than a batting of a gnat's eyelash as God counts time. He is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness. We seem to think that if we got away with it once, we're going to get away with it again. If we get away with it again the second time, we can get away with it the third time. There's a kind of an argument
that Satan the devil is willing to put up in our minds that has to do with time, the lapse of time. And as it says in the Bible, because God is not swift to punish the deeds of the wicked and so on. It's altogether set in the hearts of men to do evil. I didn't quote it exactly, but there is that attitude that people get into because they look around. They don't see God squashing people like so many bugs. And they don't see God just burning up this city or that one anymore today like he did Sodom and Gomorrah. And they don't see the punishments falling upon wicked and evil men. They think, well, maybe I can get away with it. I heard a man on an argument on television the other day talking about the most corrupt body or the most corrupt institution on the face of the earth. You know what he said it was? Pat Buchanan? The Congress. But you know, most people don't, for that matter, say, well, I think we'll just forget about the congressional system, and we'll forget about politics, and we'll forget about government of and for and by the people, because there are a few corrupt congressmen. There may be most congressmen that are corrupt, but they don't give up on Congress. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing, God is not willing, that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord, it's not a good day. He says to one of his prophets, Joel, woe be unto those that desire the day of the Lord. It is a day of blackness and gloominess and darkness, a day of a host upon the hills and the mountains, a day of burning of sackcloth and ashes, a day of God's wrath upon the earth. Many people say, oh, I want the day of the Lord to come. God says it's going to be a day of horror. It will come as a thief in the night. Ignorant people claim that means it comes secretly. That has to do with the time element. It has nothing to do with the manner. It has only to do with the time. You don't know what time a thief may come, and he may sneak in at night. But Jesus used the analogy, as did Peter, merely with regard to the time, not the method. The method is anything but a sneak thief in the middle of the night. In the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt. What are elements? Well, carbon is an element that is found throughout the creation. The hardest form of carbon is a diamond, the hardest substance known to man. Pure carbon. You know what else is pure carbon? I don't have one with me, I got a little pen, but a little lead pencil. And that substance is so slick that it just comes off. It just keeps coming off as you rub it across a piece of paper, it just comes off. And that's how you write with a pencil. Graphite is largely carbon and is used as a grease. Graphite grease is very slick the way it lines up. They actually use it as a lubricant. And if you just look up sometime carbon, you'll find what it has to do with fire. And you'll find that carbon is a common element that is absolutely common to all living things on this earth, as well as a basic fundamental element of matter itself, a part of matter. So it says here the elements, that silicon and mercury, all of those metals that we know, and every element that is a part of the molecular structure of this earth of ours, will melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Mr. Nix quoted a scripture in the third chapter of the book of James having to do with this member in my mouth. And it says that not only does that member, when we misuse it, set on fire, and that's metaphor because of what happens in the emotion and the mind, but is itself set on fire in Gehenna. He read it, didn't he, in James, the third chapter. Man, the last place in the world I want to have burning is my tongue. I mean, it's bad enough to have my little finger burned off, or my nose burned off, or my hair singed off, or burn a leg completely off, but how about setting your tongue on fire? Now, just think about it, because I'm not trying to scare you, but how often do I preach a scary sermon? Really, now, let's be honest. I don't think I preach a scary sermon one time in 10 years, and that's not what I'm trying to do. I'm just trying to make a point that we can become fireproof. And I want to show you of a time when some people did, and the only kind of people who are going to survive what is going to come. The earth, the heavens are going to pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also, and the works that are therein, shall be burned up. Malachi 4:1 says that the feet of the righteous will tread down those who are burned up or completely destroyed. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, and they are completely dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in all holy conduct and godliness? What an opposite. I told you about my friend Art. We make a little bit of a macabre joke that we try not to take a divot on hole number 14, because that's where Art is. Well, he lived out in Emerald Bay, and even though it was illegal, understand that his some people, and I won't identify them, no telling what'll happen on a tape program. It's beside the point whether it's true or not. Let's just say that allegedly Art, who was in a little urn, disappeared one night. And the rumor had it, pardon me, Henry, this is not a rumor, I think it'll hurt anyone, that Art was sprinkled all over Emerald Bay Golf Course. My point is that we are what? Is it, do they say something like 92% water, I think it says? Something like 92% water, and the rest of us are all sorts of other elements. Well, when you evaporate the water and then burn up the rest of us, even some of us 240-pounders, apparently you can get us into a little urn. And then the poor bereaved wife can put the urn there and the picture behind it and the flowers and so on, and there you are on the mantle. And that's the way a lot of people, believe it or not, keep their relatives, because they go into what is called a crematorium and they have the body cremated instead of buried across the street. We have a graveyard across the street. So it says here that they're going to melt and that the works that are therein shall be burned up. And it says that the elements, being on fire, will be dissolved and will melt with fervent heat. So that's all that's going to remain. But then even the ash, which is largely carbon, will be completely dissolved and be destroyed and be never again. So even though people like to try to reach out and claim a little bit of immortality by being a part of the elements of the earth, many people have wanted to be sprinkled at sea. Maybe if they were ship captains, they want to be sprinkled at sea, have their urn, you know, dumped out of an airplane. This man was an inveterate golfer, and there was one hole he could never conquer. It just drove him crazy. He double bogeyed the hole almost every time. He wanted his ashes spread along that particular hole because he hated it. And that was, I don't know why, but it was his own request. Crazy to think that someone would do that. But let me ask you the question again. Is God humane? You know that just shortly after the first murder, the man who was the cattle raiser among Adam's kin began to realize that in order to show an offering of peace to God, it required the burning of the flesh of a beautiful, young, innocent calf, or a cute little kid of a goat, or a lovely little soft-eyed turtle dove. And all through the days when the Levitical priesthood was in place, there was a continual fire. You could see the smoke there and the priests. And here would come the family, and you'd see them coming on the pilgrimages, and they'd be driving their little herd along. They'd have a cute little kid. Maybe one of them's carrying it. They'd be herding with a little light switch, a cute little young bullock. They'd come up to the temple, and the priest would perform a ceremony that would make most of you people sick, because you housewives go down here to Brookshire's and you buy a neat little package and you can look at the marble and the red meat and it's so wonderful, your mouth is already watering. You don't think of that as a part of a living animal. You don't think of what the animal went through. You don't think about the animal out in the field looking at you with such pretty eyes and imagine how they did it in. You're just saying, boy, it's a good-looking ribeye. Ooh, what? How much a pound? And you're just thinking about a steak that you're going to serve somebody tonight. But they drove them up to the temple, and then the priests went through all the sprinkling of the blood. Remember, we tell about it on the Day of Atonement, that actually they would take the basin, and if you're sitting around, the priests would all go out and get a portion of the blood in the basin, and all these people would be standing out there in the court, and they'd actually sprinkle the blood on the people. And so pretty soon it was just a blood-spattered ceremony. There was blood on the robe of the priest, there was blood on the ground, there was blood on various of the pillars and so on the temple, and there was blood here and blood there and blood on your necktie if you wore one, which you didn't, but I mean it was blood all over everything. And God said a little later on that he wanted mankind to learn that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Now, remission of sin didn't come through fire. It came through the shedding of blood. And so Jesus Christ of Nazareth went willing to the stake to shed his blood so that we, in accepting that sacrifice, do not have to endure that same punishment. But if we reject it, I'm here to tell you that the punishment is not humane. It is not humane. It is, if you will permit the expression, inhumane. The punishment from Almighty God is inhuman, non-human. Does not relate to humanity's ideas about what is humane. The people in Sodom and Gomorrah did not come back to make jokes like Richard Pryor about the dance you do when you're on fire. They just did their macabre death dance, shrieking and screaming their rage and their hate and their fear and their excruciating, exquisite agony until they died. And their punishment was perfectly just and holy. Do you know what the Jews call the murder through starvation, bludgeoning, unbelievable operations, privation, disease, and especially in the crematoriums and the gas chambers? You all know the term, the Holocaust. Do you know what Holocaust means? It means burnt offering. That's all it means. The Holocaust was the word used in the Hebrew language for the burnt offerings that the people offered to God when they brought the little bullock up. That was the Holocaust. And so in the Jewish race, there is no teacher among the Jews today who had remotely points out to the Jewish people that the characteristics of many of these people, which brings about oftentimes the kinds of persecution that they have suffered, not only the fact of anti-Semitism and so-called Christian civilizations as the Bavarian leader, or in this case, the corporal from Austria, who exonerated the race that he called Aryan, which is a nonsensical term anyway, which actually connotes Indo-Aryan or Northern India, if he had the wit to see it. But he's talking about an Aryan super race, meaning the blonde Nordic type, which also was absolutely nonsensical, and the creation of a super race. And so he laid every problem of the Jewish economy on the Jews. Just the other day, I'm giving a full sermon on the entire panorama of geopolitical events leading toward the unrest in Eastern Europe. I've written about it in the coming issue of Watch magazine, having to do with the eventual creation of the United States of Europe. And I'm going through all of the scenario, the background behind some of these countries, such as Czechoslovakia, which was not even a country until about 1919, when it was subdivided up among all of the other states. And then left the Sudetenland Germans, of course, in this artificial a political entity following the Treaty of Versailles, which led partially to Hitler's claims upon Czechoslovakia, and therefore one of the catalysts that began World War II. And when I get through with all of this and about the identity of Israel and the Great Tribulation and how God is going to cause Jacob's punishment, which is the tribulation, the wrath, which is the Great Tribulation, to come upon Jacob, God's people, Israel. I have a man come up to me. "You got a few minutes?" I said, "Well, be happy to answer your question." "Well, you got a few minutes? If you got just a few minutes, I'll change your mind." I says, "Oh, about what?" He said, "About everything you just said." "Oh," I said, "you'd have to have 10 years, and you still wouldn't get me to change my mind." And so then he began to tell me about the Jews. It's all a Jewish conspiracy. There's a whole bunch of Jews up in an attic somewhere. And there's David, you know, there are all these people in the Chase Manhattan Bank. And there's the Trilateral Convention. And there are all kinds of people in Brussels with a huge computer keeping track of you. And they're behind the money and the gold and the silver. And they're all in contact with each other. They're already ruling the world. They're calling all the shots. And they're watching you. Now, you know, he didn't say all of that. But, I mean, I'm familiar with all of the conspiracy theories and also very, very familiar with the incredible amount of anti-Semitism and people who are fair game for that type of thing, who will believe the same lies that Joseph Goebbels published among the German people in 1936, 7, 8, and 9 about a Jewish conspiracy. And there are many people in the United States of America who believe it today. Do you know what the Bible says in Matthew 24 about the future of the capital city of Israel? The Bible says it's going to happen again, doesn't it? The Bible plainly says that before the time of the great, you know, in the terrible day of the Lord, during the Great Tribulation, that not one stone is going to remain standing in its original place. And they still are in their original places today. Only the top of the walls were prized loose by the armies under Titus and destroyed in Jerusalem. And Christ said that another Holocaust is going to occur. There is not one great Jewish leader, not one Jewish prophet or Jewish rabbi on this earth who has ever gone to the people of Judah, Levi, or Simeon, or any of the people who would call themselves Jew, and said to them, "Don't you know why you people have been suffering? Don't you know why you were offered like a holocaust on an altar, like a daily burnt offering?" There is no one yet. Now think through, if you will, for a moment. A lot of people you've known, whether Baptists or Presbyterians or Lutherans or what, and trying to convince them, like these farmers up there hiring a local Indian to come out and give a rain dance, or like the people in churches all over our land today, in state after state, save two or three or four, that are actually meeting in churches by the tens of thousands and praying for rain. And then try to convince them that the drought is coming as a punishment from God because of their way of life, while they're in their churches feeling holy and praying to God to send rain. Try to convince them. I have puzzled over whether or not God is going to allow tens of millions of people to say to him, "Well, is that it? Why, if you just told me that it only had to do with keeping the Sabbath and obeying the Ten Commandments of God, and keeping the Feast of Tabernacles, well, I would have done that. But I went to church every Sunday, and I was a good Baptist, and I did catechism, and I repeated the doxology, or I was a good Catholic, and I did my rosary and all that, and I just didn't know." In other words, is God going to leave people by the tens of millions without a witness? A lady came to me, and she was very upset over the idea of a second chance. And it took me quite a while, but I finally got across one concept to her, and her eyes kind of lit up like a little light began to dawn. She began to see something for the first time. We discussed people in Vietnam and China and Japan and all around the world. I get some very interesting people to come up to me by the hundreds when I'm out shaking hands and talking to people after some of these meetings in faraway cities. And I said, "Do they deserve a chance?" And I finally kept using the language, "A chance. Should they have a chance?" And she began to understand, well, yes, they ought to have a chance. And I said, "That's just it. They've never had a chance. No one's ever told them. They've never heard." So we got down to what constitutes a chance. Well, a chance is having two clearly described, plain, simple, easy to understand alternatives. Two separate choices. Gehenna fire and the way of every evil on the way there. Rape, child molestation, thievery, lying, mugging, crime, murder, war, you name it. Homosexuality, sodomy. And Gehenna at the end of it. Or on the other way, everything that any human being has ever been able to put down on his want list. Health, happiness, success, love, appreciation, forgiveness, reward, everything beautiful, everything you've always wanted, because God's law will produce those things if we simply obey God's law. It's virtually automatic. Plus, God does bless those that serve him. And that wonderful way, which Jesus said is rocky and rutty and straight, meaning difficult and narrow, not the broad, well-lit avenue that leads down to the honky-tonk palace and says, "This way, all ye who enter into Gehenna." And only when a person has had that completely explained to the point each choice is clear, and then they consciously decide, "No, I want the broad, glittering way to do my dance when I'm on fire," are they going to lose out? And the work that Jesus Christ of Nazareth once done on this earth during this time is a work of making those choices clear. I was once accused of robbing the pulpit of its power by taking away the threat of hellfire. And I want to amend that misconception with this sermon. No, the Bible does not take away the threat of hellfire. It absolutely resubstantiates it, and it says that God is going to burn alive all sinners who will not repent, but who will to remain in sin, unrepentant, and unforgiven. There is so much I could read back in Deuteronomy 4, and Leviticus 9:24, and 2 Chronicles 7:1, where God's supernatural fire began the burning of the altar in the temple after Solomon's dedication prayer. You see the Olympics, and they run with this so-called fire of theirs, which is a pagan ritual. And yet when Solomon had finished praying and saying, "Let us hear your voice, and wherever we come to confess our sins, that we will know you are here, and this is your house," and they got the bullocks and everything ready, and with a whoosh, a fire from God began that daily place of burnt offering. And it was kept perpetual burning because God started it. And it was looked upon as a sign from heaven above. Yes, God appears in fire. God appeared in fire to Ezekiel. He saw fire from the loins upward and the loins downward, and a huge fiery apparatus like a fiery chariot, in which Jesus Christ, the one who was the member of the God family who came down to this earth, was conveyed here and there through the universe and appeared to some of his prophets in the past. And so imbued with that knowledge and information, the Apostle Paul talked about, you are come unto this heavenly Jerusalem, and our God is a consuming fire. Let's turn to the third chapter of the book of Daniel right quickly. And you know, of course, what this is all about. We tend to think that Hitler and his rotten minions were the first people to come up with the idea of crematoriums. Well, they were not. Ancient Babylon had that mode for doing away with political prisoners or with religious dissidents. And in this case, in the third chapter of the book of Daniel, we read about how the Chaldeans, who were actually an occultist sect, in the eighth verse, came near and accused the Jews and spoke unto the king, "O King Nebuchadnezzar, live forever." So right away the king lived forever. I've got to throw that in, I'm sorry. "Thou, O King, hast made a decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoever doesn't fall down and worship it shall be cast into the midst of a burning, fiery furnace." There are certain Jews, interesting, isn't it? Jews being thrown into a fiery furnace. But these were Jews with a difference. They were young princes who had refused the king's table, who had refused the unclean meats, and who had been specially chosen of God under Daniel for a very great and a high calling. He had set them over the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Actually, Hananiah, Azariah, and Mishael were their original names. "These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not your gods, nor worship the golden image which you have set up." Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, he was like a lot of despotic leaders. The sycophantic interlopers around him were able to trigger his rage and his fury and imagine slights at third persons, and so he was susceptible to that. He commanded that they drag these people in there. One moment, they're at the top of the province. One moment, they're cabinet-level ministers. The next moment, into the fire they go. And they brought them. He demanded to know the truth. And he said, "Now we're going to find out, verse 15, if you'll do it and you'll fall down. Otherwise, you're going to be cast into a fiery furnace." And they answered him this in verse 17. "If it be so," notice that they did not say with braggadocio, "No way, O king, we're not going to burn." Interesting language, because it shows that their attitude was, either way, my mind is made up. No matter the outcome, and they probably expected to be burnt up. So it wasn't braggadocio. They didn't have such great faith that they said, "Sure, let's walk into the fire for a while." They just said, "If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace." They did know that much about God. "And he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not," even if he doesn't, "I want to explain something to you, O king. Be it known unto you, O king, that we will not serve your gods, nor worship the golden image which you have set up." You don't say that to a king very lightly. You don't look at a king in the eye when he tells you to do something and say, "I won't do it." But you do when there's a higher king that tells you obey God first, and man only when and if the two do not conflict. Then Nebuchadnezzar, full of fury, and nothing makes a despot madder than to directly defy his order. And the form of his visage was changed, meaning it was all like a prune, all screwed up in an angry, hate-filled mask. Against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, therefore he spoke and commanded that they should heat the furnace 1 7 times more than it was wont to be heated. Get the bellows out there. You know, that's the principle of a jet engine. You have a turbine section that compresses air to force the air in there. And if you can force enough air through there, it just gets hotter and hotter and hotter. So they got these huge bellows working, and they got that thing so hot that it was about to burn the brick in the furnace out. And he commanded the most mighty men that were in his army to bind them. Why? Was he worried about somebody going to break them loose? This one wanted to make sure. 7 times hotter, and that's probably metaphor, because, you know, it couldn't have been heated up to 700 and, or whatever, some degrees, or it would have been in this case 1400 degrees plus, and cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their coats, their hosen, and their hats, and their other garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's commandment was urgent and the furnace exceeding hot, they opened it up, a draft of air came blowing out of there, and actually slew the people who threw them in. And that's also a shadowy type of what happened to the Germans, who said, Abe, I want you to understand, I don't have anything against the Jews, I like Jews, but I have to follow the orders, Heil Hitler, and in they went. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound into the midst of the burning fiery furnace, like a coke oven or a Bessemer oven. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king was astonished and rose up in haste and spoke unto his counselors. Didn't we cast 3 men bound into the midst of the fire? And they said, true, O king. And he said, well, I see 4 men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the fiery furnace and said, calling out their names, you servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. So they walked out, and the princes, governors, captains, counselors gathered together, saw them. They didn't even smell like they'd been near the fire. Their beards, mustaches, hair was not even singed. Their coats hadn't even been singed, nor the smell of fire passed on them. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants that trusted in him and have changed the king's word. And that was the part that really amazed him. The most amazing thing of all was that his word could be changed, and yielded their bodies that they might not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree. Don't kid yourself that the man was completely heartbroken and repentant. He climbed up on his little castle tower immediately, and he was in charge here, so he decided that he would decree that this God is a God that everybody's going to worship. I make a decree that every people, nation, and language which speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses made a dunghill, because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. He tried to salvage his ego, and away he went, but the king promoted them in the province of Babylon. I think that that is a type of Gehenna fire, that God's servants were not even touched, and yet everything around them was burning with a temperature probably several hundred degrees centigrade, and it didn't even singe the hair of their head. Now in Malachi 3 and verse 2, it says that when Jesus Christ of Nazareth comes to stand on this earth, quote, he is like a refiner's fire. In the 3rd chapter, 1 Corinthians, it lists 6 building materials, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, and stubble, each of which have a different flash point or kindling point. Gold, of course, can be purified by fire, as can silver, which is not as valuable as gold, but can still be purified by fire. In Luke 12 and verse 49, Jesus said, I am come to start a fire on this earth. He was talking about a fiery controversy. And when John the Baptist preached to the people, he said that Jesus Christ was coming like a burning fire, and that the stubble and the thorns were going to be collected and thrown into that fire, and told the Pharisees that there was coming a baptism with fire. Ignorant people have taken that very awesome warning about a coming Gehenna fire and turned it into an ecstatic, gibberish, you know, Terry meeting, having a Pentecostal experience, when in fact John the Baptist was warning that the Pharisees, if they did not bring forth fruit fitting for repentance, would themselves someday be burnt up. In Revelation 3 and verse 18, the Bible says, Jesus Christ says to God's church, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, already tried in the fire. Merely again, metaphor. I counsel you to so improve your character, to allow my Holy Spirit to improve your character, to knock off the rough edges, get rid of sin in your life, to overcome, to be the kind of an individual who is going to be durable even through such a terrible time, that it will survive and even be purified in fire. Now, we already read 2 Peter, the third chapter, so I won't turn back to that again. He calls his angels a flame of fire and says in Hebrews 12, 29, as we read, our God is a consuming fire. No, God, several times in the course of human experience, has shown exactly what he thinks of sin. And he shows exactly what is its reward. Isn't it quite a commentary that our reluctant court system and our criminal justice system, in the most extreme heinous cases involving mass killings, will on a very rare occasion decide that rotten, bestial, filthy thing that perpetrated those hideous, unspeakable acts should forfeit his own life. But even then, we let the nurse come up with a swab and the little tap and insert the little needle. Did that hurt? Sorry. And are you ready? And then they go into a peaceful sleep. And they call it humane. God is not humane. The punishment for sin is to burn, yes, even the tongue, in Gehenna fire. And I don't want that kind of punishment, because I can't stand to hold my little finger over a lit match for the count of three. Can you?